أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. صدق الله العظيم.
أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الناس كلوا مما في الأرض حلالا طيبا ولا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين. إنما يأمركم بالسوء والفحشاء وأن تقولوا على الله ما لا تعلمون. فإذا قيل لهم اتبعوا ما أنزل الله قالوا بل نتبع ما ألفينا عليه آباءنا أولو كان آباؤهم لا يعقلون شيئا ولا يهتدون. صدق الله العظيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ربنا الهمنا رشدنا واعذنا من شرور انفسنا. اللهم ارحمنا بالقران العظيم واجعله لنا اماما ونورا وهدى ورحمه. امين يا رب العالمين. Before we start with this 21st section of Surah Al-Baqarah, please note two points. As I told you, that the four strands of the issues which are discussed in the second part, one is regarding the Sharia, Ahkamu Sharia. Number two point, that just as we find in the end, in the last part of the first section, first half of the surah, there was mention of the pagan Arabs, the idolaters, the mushrikeen of the Arabian Peninsula. In the same way, in the second half also, we find in this ruku a reference to them. And that is, just as I said that in the previous section, it's the last mention of the Ahlul Kitab, of the Jews and Christians in this Surah Al-Baqarah. In this way, in this section, this is the last reference to the pagan Arabs, to the idol-worshipping Arabs in this surah. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. O people, O mankind, eat from whatever is in the earth which is halal, lawful, and طَيِّبًا, good and refined. وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. And don't follow the footsteps of shaitan. إِنَّهُ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. Verily, he is for you a clear enemy. Now two things. كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضُ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. Whatever is halal, permissible, eat it. Don't refrain from eating anything which is declared by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as permissible, as halal. Shaitan attacks human beings in two ways. He will persuade you to eat what is haram. And then he will give you different waswasa, different ideas about things which are halal. And he will ask you not to eat them, not to go near them. So actually keep both these things in your view. كُلُوا مِمَّا فِي الْأَرْضِ حَلَالًا طَيِّبًا. Eat whatever is halal and whatever is tayyab, whatever is good in all the earth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided you with food. And don't follow the footsteps of shaitan. He is for you a clear enemy. إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُكُمْ بِالسُّوءِ. He actually ordains you, he commands you to whatever is evil, وَالْفَحْشَىٰ, what is sinful, وَأَن تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And he also commands you to say something about Allah what you not know, without any knowledge. And it has another meaning also, to ascribe to Allah something about which you have no knowledge. That Allah has declared this thing to be haram. Whereas we don't find anything in the Quran or in any revealed scripture that this is haram. This has been declared haram from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you know, he will ascribe these things. Just as the people in the Arabian Peninsula, they had declared many things to be haram. The Jews had declared the meat of camel to be haram, although there was no proof. Only Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam didn't like it personally. It was his liking or disliking, that's all, personal liking or disliking. But they declared it to be haram. In the same way, there were animals in the Arabian Peninsula who were given the names, you know, for certain gods, that this is reserved for that god and this is reserved for that god. And certain animals who had brought forth some offspring, some number of offsprings, after them now they are haram. You cannot take any service from them, you cannot eat their flesh, although those animals were halal in themselves. So all these things are covered by these ayat. إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُكُمْ بِالسُّوءِ وَالْفَحْشَاءِ وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And you ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala those things which you don't know. وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمُ اتَّبِعُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ. And when it is said to them, follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down, what He has revealed. قَالُوا بَلْ نَتَّبِعُ مَا أَلْفَيْنَا عَلَيْهِ آبَانَا. They say, instead, we shall follow on what we found our forefathers. Whatever they were doing, whatever their practices, we shall follow them. أَوَلَوْ كَانَ أَبَاهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ شَيْئًا. What? Will they follow their fathers, forefathers? Although it may be that their fathers were not knowing anything, but not understanding anything. أَوَلَوْ كَانَ أَبَاهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَهْتَدُونَ. And they were not the guided people, they were not on the guidance. وَمَثَلُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا كَمَثَلِ الَّذِي يَنْعِقُ بِمَا لَا يَسْمَعُ إِلَّا دُعَاءً وَنِدَاءً. And the likeness of these people, these kuffar, who worship idols, and who call them, their gods, their idols, for help, and pray to them, prostrate before them, their likeness is to the people, to a shepherd who calls his flock of sheep. Although this flock of sheep, they understand nothing. But only that someone is crying and someone is, you know, calling. Except that. So just like animals, these idols even don't understand, don't hear. But they are calling them and they are praying to them. Summun bukmun umyun fahum la yaqilun. They hear nothing, they are dumb, they are deaf, they are blind, so they do not understand. Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu kulu min tayyibati ma razaqnakum. Again, repeating. O you who believe. In the beginning it was Ya ayyuhan nas. The address was to the whole of humanity. It was in the generalized terms. Now it is particularly the Muslims are addressed here. Ya ayyuha allatheena amanu kulu min tayyibati ma razaqnakum. Eat from the good things with which we have provided you. Washkuru lillah. And be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In kuntum iyyahu ta'budun. If you really worship Him and obey Him. إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةَ. He has declared for you haram and He has forbade you from eating what? Four things. Al-Maita, the flesh of dead animals. Wa-Dama, and the blood. Wa-Lahma al-Khinzir, and the flesh of swine. وَمَا أُهِلَّ بِهِ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ. And whatever was sacrificed in the name of anything else, anyone else except Allah. فَمَنِ اسْتُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ. Then whosoever is forced by necessity, he has nothing else to eat, and he is dying of hunger, he can eat from these things even. Although these things have been declared to be haram, najis, in itself, in themselves. But a person who has nothing to eat, who cannot find anything more to eat, any other thing to eat, and he is going to die of hunger, he is allowed to eat from these also. فَمَنِ اسْتُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ. There are two conditions. There must be no craving for it. You say that I am eating pork because I have no other thing to eat here. No. You are not going to die without taking pork here. Then maybe that you have some craving within your heart for this, and you are only, you know, using it as a lame excuse and nothing else. There should be no craving for it, no liking for it, wala adin. And only that much amount can be taken which will save you from dying, not more. فَمَنْ اِسْتُرَّ غَيْرَ بَاغٍ وَلَا عَادٍ فَلَا إِسْمَ عَلَيْهِ. On such a person, if he takes some of these things which are forbidden, which are haram in themselves, there is no sin on him. إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is forgiving and he is merciful. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَكْتُمُونَ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ. Verily those who hide and conceal what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down from the book, in the book, وَيَشْتَرُونَ بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. And they are purchasing, like accepting, in exchange, very low price. أُولَٰئِكَ مَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ إِلَّا النَّارِ. They are the people who are not eating into their stomachs and bellies except fire, fire of hell. Although they might be eating very tasty foods, but this is actually the fire of hell, the cinders, burning cinders of hell, which they are putting in their stomachs and bellies. وَلَا يُكَلَّمُهُمُ اللَّهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. Allah will not speak to them on the day of judgment, on the doomsday. وَلَا يُزَكِّيهِمْ. And He will not purify them. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابُ الْعَلِيمِ. And for them is a very painful torment. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ اشْتَرَبُوا الضَّلَالَةَ بِالْهُدَىٰ. They are the people who have purchased zalalah, error, and going astray in exchange for hidayah, hudan, in exchange for guidance. They have given up guidance, accepted zalalah. وَالْعَذَابَ بِالْمَغْفِرَةِ. They have exchanged azab for maghfirah. They could have maghfirah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they have given it up and they have chosen the punishment and the torment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَمَا أَصْبَرَهُمْ عَلَى النَّارِ. How bold they are for the fire of hell. ذَلِكَ بِأَنَّ اللَّهَ نَزَلَ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ. And this is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down His book with haq, with whole truth, the total truth. وَإِنَّ الَّذِينَ اخْتَلَفُوا فِي الْكِتَابِ لَفِي شِقَاقٍ بَعِيدٍ. And verily, surely those who are making differences concerning this book, who are differing concerning this book, they are in a very far away enmity, shiqaqin ba'id. They have gone far away in enmity and arrogance. Now comes a very big ayah of the Quran and a very grand ayah. It gives us a very comprehensive view of what is the virtue, what's the concept of virtue and goodness in Islam. لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. It's not all charity, all good, that you turn your faces towards the east and west. The same subject, you know, there are two full sections of the Quran, of this Surah Al-Baqarah, which discuss directly the issue of the changing of the direction of the Qibla. But two sections before we found the beginning, لِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبُ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجْهُ اللَّهِ. And two sections later, we are again having the mention of the same issue. Don't think that this is all virtue and this is most important. You have attached, you know, out of proportion importance to this issue. لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ. The real charity, real good, real virtue is not that you turn your faces towards the east or west. وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ. But actually charity and virtue is the virtue of a person. مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ. The first precondition of virtue and goodness and all good is to have faith in Allah, who has belief and faith in Allah, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ and the last day, وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ and the angels, وَالْكِتَابِ and the books, وَالنَّبِيِّينَ and the prophets. And number two, what is the manifestation, practical manifestation of this iman? Number one, وَآتَ الْمَالَ عَلَىٰ حُبِّهِ ذَوِي الْقُرْبَىٰ وَالْيَتَامَىٰ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنَ السَّبِيلِ وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ. They give away their own belongings, their own wealth, although they themselves love it, in spite of their love for it. This maal, this wealth is definitely dear to their hearts. But despite this love for them, for this property and wealth, they spend it. And they spend it for whom? Zawil Qurba, close in relationship. Wal Yatama, and the orphans. Wal Masakeen, and the poor. Wabna Sabeel, and the wayfarer. Wal Sa'ileen, and the beggars. Wafil Riqab, and in releasing the people from the bondage of slavery and maybe also of debt. وَابْنَ السَّمِيلَ وَالسَّائِلِينَ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةِ. Second practical manifestation, and he established the regular prayers. وَآتَ الزَّكَاةِ, and he paid the charity, the regular charity, the compulsory charity. And number four, وَالْمُوفُونَ بِأَحْدِهِمْ إِذَا أَحَدُوا. And those who fulfill their words and promises and contracts, when they have made any contract, any promise. And number five, and last but not the least, rather we should say the most important, وَالصَّابِرِينَ فِي الْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَحِينَ الْبَأْسِ. Those who show perseverance and patience in distress and affliction, and at the time of conflict and war, and they are steadfast, they are perseverance, they show patience, and they are ready to risk everything for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ صَدَقُوا وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. They are the people who are really truthful, and they are the people who are really pious, who are really God-fearing. Now this is, as you have seen, this ayah, the name of this ayah can be Ayatul Birr, the ayah which gives us a comprehensive view of what is birr, what is virtue, what is, you know, charity. And this gives us a full character picture of a person. Because, you know, the goodness or iman, real faith, it permeates the whole personality of a person. The whole personality is changed. If there is real iman in the heart, وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَالْمَلَائِكَةِ وَالْكِتَابِ وَالنَّبِيِّينَ. That real iman in the heart will change and transform the whole character, the whole personality of a man. And that has been described in five terms. Number one, that he gives away his wealth, although it is dear to him, for the needy, the poor, the orphans, and so on. Number two, established prayer, pays the regular zakat, and he fulfills the promises that he makes, the contracts. Whatever he has given word, he sticks to them. And finally, then he is steadfast. In the struggle between evil and good, he fights the evil, he challenges the evil. And if there is time to have patience, if there is persecution, if there is opposition, and he is afflicted with distress, pain, he has to go hungry, he has to take risks about his own life. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنْفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ, which we read that ayah in the 19th section. So that gives us a total picture of a man, of a person, of a character who is liked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is actually a good person. He is actually the one whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْقِصَاصِ. O you who believe, now there is, again, you know, some commandments about mu'amalat, the affairs of the world, about the cases in, you know, murder. Because in every human society there can be killing, slaying, and murder. Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu kutiba alaykumul qisasu fil qatla. O you who believe, the law of equitable retribution concerning the slain, the murdered one, that has been made essential for you, kutiba alaykum. It has been made imperative on you. You have to abide by this law of equitable retribution concerning the cases of slaying and killing and murdering. Al-hurru bil-hur. A free man in the place of a free man, he will have to die. If he had committed the murder, he will have to die, or he will have to pay the blood money. Wal-abd bil-abd. And if it is a slave, then the slave will die. Not that because the slave, he has killed a free man, so he is not equal to his life. No. A man is equal to every other man as regards the life. وَالْأُنْسَى بِالْأُنْسَى. And if the murderer is a woman, then that woman will go. فَمَنْ أُوفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ شَيْءٌ Whosoever is, you know, is for whomsoever something is diminished from his brother. Now the brother of the slain, of the murdered person, of the killed person, their kith and kin, if they are ready to pardon him, it is as if they have done some favor to him. فَمَنْ عُفِيَ لَهُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ شَيْءٌ If they have accepted the blood money, that is also a mercy to him, to the murderer, to the killer. فَاتِّبَعُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ So then it should be given alleviation from your Lord. It should be in the proper way. عَدَعُونَ إِلَيْهِ بِإِحْسَانِ And that blood money should be paid to them in a very beautiful way. Not grudgingly. عَدَعُونَ إِلَيْهِ بِإِحْسَانِ ذَلِكَ تَخْفِيفٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَرَحْمَةٌ And this is an alleviation, a decrease, a leniency from your Lord and a mercy. فَمَنْ اِعْتَدَى بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ Whosoever transgresses even after that, he has accepted the blood money also, and he is after the taking the life of the killer also. Whosoever does both the things, فَلَهُ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ For him there is a very painful punishment. So this is the beauty of the Islamic law about these cases of murder, you know. If somebody is murdered, he has gone. Now, even if the killer is killed, the family of the murdered person gets nothing. But if, you know, this family pardons the killer, now this killer, you know, this murderer is under an ihsan of those people. And you know, this will be good for both the parties. Otherwise, especially the tribal societies, killings go on, revenge taken from one tribe, then the people of the other tribe kill so many people of that tribe, then again this tribe takes the revenge and kills so many people of that tribe. It goes on. You know, in dynasties it goes on. Generation after generation it goes on. But this law, you know, it can produce a full stop. It can place a full stop on all these things, because now the duty of the state is to procure and hold the, and get that murderer, bring him to book. Now you place him at the mercy of the family of the man who was murdered. That family has the authority. If they want to forgive him, they can forgive him. If they want to accept blood money, they can accept blood money. So that is actually the beauty and the wisdom of the divine law in the case of murder. وَلَكُمْ فِي الْقِصَاصِ حَيَاتٌ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ And for you, O people of understanding, there is life in this law of equitable retribution concerning the slain, so that you may be saved. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذَا أَذَرَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ إِنْ تَرَكَ خَيْرًا الْوَسِيَّةِ It has been made obligatory upon you if death comes and comes, the time of dying comes of a person amongst you, if he is leaving behind him some wealth, that he should prepare and give a will, wasiyah, lil walidain, for the parents, wal aqrabeen, and the close in kith and kin, bil ma'roof, in a proper way, in a proper manner, in a reasonable, equitable manner. Haqqan lil muttaqeen. It's a duty upon all people who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Actually, this ayah has been abrogated in toto. Because when in Suratul Nisa, the law of inheritance was revealed in this detail, this is the portion of the father of the diseased, this is the portion of the mother of the diseased, and this is the portion of the daughters, this is the portion of the sons, and if there is none among the parents or the offsprings, then you know this wealth can go to the brothers and sisters and so on. When that law was revealed, this thing was abrogated. Now it is not necessary for any Muslim to prepare a will, because all whatever he leaves behind him, it will be distributed according to the law of the Sharia, law of inheritance. But you know, if somebody wants to make a will, he can make up till 1/3 of his property only. And none of the inheritors, the regular inheritors according to the Islamic law, cannot be given anything in the will. That is the portion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has fixed. They will get only the fixed portion. This will can be only for other people, some poor people, some institutions, some work of charity that can be given, you know, but up till the limit of one third of the total property, not all, not more than one third. So this is applicable only now to the one third of the property of a person who has died, and rest of it will definitely be distributed according to the law, detailed law, which is revealed in Surah An-Nisa. So this, it can also be said that this ayah has been abrogated totally, because it is no more essential, obligatory for a Muslim to have a will. So, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذَا حَضَرَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ إِنْ تَرَكَ خَيْرًا لِلْوَصِيَّةِ. This commandment has been abrogated in toto. But a part of it has been retained by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is from Sunnah, that if somebody wants to give something to in a will, then he can do it up till one third of his property. فَمَنْ بَدَّلَهُ بَعْدَ مَا سَمِعَهُ. But then whosoever changes it after he had listened to it, فَإِنَّمَا إِسْمُهُ عَلَى الَّذِينَ يُبَدِّلُونَهُ. So the sin of it will be on those who change it. A person is dying and he has given a will, supposedly, verbally only, but the people who were there, they have now changed. They say, no, no, he said not that thing, but he said this thing. So now the person who has died is not responsible. He will not to be blamed on the day of judgment. It will be those who have changed his will, they will be brought to the book and they will be blamed. In Allah Samiun Alim, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens to everything and he knows everything. فَمَنْ خَافَ مِنْ مُوسٍ جَنَفًا. Whosoever fears that the deceased person, the person who has died and who has given a will, جَنَفًا أَوْ إِسْمًا, he has done some injustice in his will, or he has done some wrongdoing, if there is the fear that he has committed a mistake, he shouldn't have done this, it is unjust. The distribution that he has given in his will is not based on justice. فَأَصْلَحَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Then there must be a dispute. Those who have been given less, they will stand and demand more. But then if they agreeably, if they change it and they set it the matter right by mutual consultation, فَأَصْلَحَ بَيْنَهُمْ فَلَا إِسْمَ عَلَيْهِ, then there is no sin on them. It is not sacrosanct that whatever the will is, it has to be implemented as such. No. If it is thought that it is unjust, injustice has been done, and then now by mutual agreement, some adjustments are made, so there is no harm in it, and there will be no sin in it. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السَّيَامُ. Now the other strand, and that is of ibadat. Now psalm. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السَّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O you who profess to believe, keeping fast has been made mandatory for you, just as it was made mandatory for them who were before you. This was there in the Sharia of Moses alayhi salam also. Psalm was there in their Sharia. In the same way, now this psalm, siyam, keeping fast, has been made obligatory on you. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you have real taqwa. So that you have self-control over your animal instincts. You have full control of your id and libido. أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. As I told you, I think that these two ayat, they concern the first commandment that was given by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the people after Hijrah, that every Muslim should keep three fasts every month, because the Arabs were not accustomed to fasting. So they were gradually accustomed to it in a manner that every month, now you see, the month could be December, when fasting is easy. The month could be July or August or May, when the fasting is very difficult. So 3 days every month, it becomes very easy. Different weathers, different seasons, and only 3 days. But when it is full month, it's not a simple case. It's definitely something very hard. So first order was for 3 days, 13th, 14th, 15th of every lunar month. That was the commandment. That is why the words are used, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ. They are a few days. 30 days are not few days. 30 days are quite a big number. Ayyama madudat, only a few days, 3 days. Faman kana minkum marizan, and regarding these 3 days also, there are two concessions. Concession number one, whosoever may be from amongst you ill, sick, or ala safarin, or on some travel, fa'iddatu min ayyamin ukhra, he can complete that number in other days. 3 days, he can keep the fast in that month on any other 3 days. Number two, وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ, and on them who has the power to keep psalm, to keep fasting, they are not ill, they are not sick, they are not on traveling, and then they don't want to keep fast. فِدْيَةٌ طَعَامُ مِسْكِينٌ, there is a redemption for them, that they should feed one poor person. فَمَنْ تَتَوَّى خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ, and whosoever voluntarily does more good, well, it is good for him. If he feeds 2 or 3 or 10 or 20, well, he will get the reward on the day of judgment. If someone keeps the fast also, and also is feeding the hungry, well, he is doing it voluntarily. So there is no limit to the voluntary good deeds that a man can perform. وَأَنْتَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ, now this is the persuasion. Don't avail of this number two concession. There is the concession, but don't avail of it. وَأَنْتَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ, if you fast, if you keep the fast, it is better for you. إِنْ كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ, if you have the real knowledge. If you know what is really good for you, what is really beneficial for you. For because fasting, you know, that is beneficial for your ruh, for your spirit. And you need it. While you know, if you have only given some charity and you have fed a few hungry people, well, that ruh will not get the food that would have given to him if you had fasted. Now comes the final commandment about the Shahr Ramadan, the month of Ramadan. Shahr Ramadan alladhi unzila fihi al-Qur'an. Month of Ramadan is the month in which Qur'an was sent down. I had already discussed it in my preliminary lecture. Qur'an was sent down in 2 stages. Stage number one, from the Kitabim Mahfuz, Lawhim Mahfuz, Kitabim Maknoon, fi Ummil Kitab, to the first heaven, to the first sky. And that was done in toto, at once, one piece, in one night. That night is Laylatul Qadr, and in one month, that was Ramadan. That is Inzal. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن إنا أنزلناه في ليلة القدر. And second stage was that from there, the Archangel Jibreel عليه الصلاة والسلام brought down Quran bit by bit, piece by piece, to the heart of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And this second stage took 22 years, beginning in the year 610 of Christian era, and ending in the year 632 of the Christian era, when Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم died. So these are the 2 stages. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. And what is this Quran? The guidance for whole of humanity. Now we can very easily compare. Here we find guidance for whole of humanity. And in the beginning of this surah was guidance for the muttaqeen, هدى للمتقين. How do you correlate these both? That in itself it is guidance, it keeps and it holds. It has the guidance for the whole of humanity. But you know, only those will be able to avail the guidance of Quran who have real taqwa in them, who are God-fearing, who want to save them, who have the real and living moral law within them. The sense, moral sense is there. They know what is bad, what is good. They want to be good. For them only, they can only avail the from the guidance of this book. هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ وَبَيِّنَاتِ مِنَ الْهُدَىٰ, and this guidance is in very clear terms, bayyinat, self-evident. وَالْفُرْقَانِ, and the criterion between good and bad, evil and good, between false and real. فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرَ فَلْيَصُمْ, now whosoever of you witnesses this month, he has to keep fasting throughout the month. فَلْيَصُمْ هُ, this pronoun ho is going towards Shahr Ramadan. The whole month of Ramadan you have to keep fasting. وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ. Of the original two concessions, one has been retained, and that is why it has been repeated. Whosoever among you is ill or sick, أَوْ عَلَىٰ سَفَرٍ, or he is on some travel, فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ, he will complete the number. If the number was 30 days of Ramadan, you have to complete 30 days. If the number was that year 29 days of Ramadan, you have to complete 29 days. That number of the month of Ramadan has to be completed. The second concession is now abrogated. That is no more. But here also we find, you know, from the wisdom of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he has retained for a very extreme cases, a man who is very sick, and he cannot keep fasting. There is fear that he may die. Another, a person, he is suffering from a disease from which there is no hope of recovery. And he cannot bear this hardship of fasting. For them, you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has retained that option, that in place of one day of fasting, they can feed one poor person. But not generally, not the healthy people, not the people who can go to fast. They cannot avail of this concession now. This is gone forever. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah intends for you easiness, ease, not difficulty. Don't be cruel to yourself. If you are suffering from fever, high fever, don't keep the fast. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you the concession, He intends for you ease, not difficulty. وَلَتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ. But anyhow, you have to complete the figure, the number now. That is obligatory. That figure, that number is to be completed. وَلَتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ. And so that you glorify Allah. Rather, the word should be magnify Allah. Takbir means to make something bigger and bigger. Allahu Akbar, Allah is the greatest. So now the saying Allahu Akbar, this is takbir. But actually only saying is not sufficient. To make Allah supreme, to make the deen of Allah supreme, so that He is obeyed in all aspects of life, it is actually takbir of the Rabb, that He is really accepted as great, as the biggest, as the greatest, as the authority, as the sovereign, sovereignty blessed with Him. So actually this is takbir. وَلَتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ. But this takbir, in, you know, after the psalm, after the month of Ramadan, when there is Eid, then we have special takbir. In the Salah of Eid, there are additional takbir. This takbir saying Allahu Akbar is also takbir. وَلَتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَىٰ مَا هَدَاكُمْ. And this takbir is on the guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. You should magnify Him, glorify Him on the guidance that He gave you. The blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that came to you in the form of Quran. وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. And so that you can really be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now this has a very deep meaning. As I told you, man is composed of two constituent parts. The animal existence, the material existence, and the spiritual existence. Both are self-sufficient and independent, joined together. The tendencies of both are different, rather opposite to each other. One has come from this earth, from the clay of the earth, from the crust of the earth. The other has come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَسَلُونَكَ عَلِ الرُّوحِ قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّي. Our animal being, the source is this earth. And everything that we need for this animal being, for its feeding, for its requirements, all things come from there, from the earth. The food is coming from there. Everything which rejuvenates this body, this animal existence, coming from the earth. And now for this ruh, something that comes from Him, from whom the ruh has come, that is the only thing that can give Him it the strength, the real life, the vigor. This ruh needs, you know, feeding. And the food of this ruh and this spirit is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it is in itself manifestation of the word of kun. Kun fayakun. Every ruh of ours is a word of kun from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know, its strength would be, it will be strengthened, it will be revived, it will be rejuvenated, it will be revitalized by the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by Quran. And that is what we are doing. Keeping the fast during the day, and during night we are awake with this Quran. Actually, this is the two-pronged attack for this spiritual purification during the month of Ramadan. During the day, you are with fast. You are suppressing your animal existence. You are weakening it. At least some weakening is there. Although the weather may be very good, but then starvation, refraining from food and drinking, it has that effect, definite effect. And then in the night, keep awake, stand, listen to Allah's kalam, His words, let it be absorbed in the soils of your hearts and your minds. And that is actually, then you will know what a big blessing this Quran is. And then you will be able to give the thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala proportionately. And the next result is, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When the ruh awakens, when the ruh is revitalized, it wants to get nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to its real source. كُلُّ شَيْءٍ يَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ أَصْلِهِ. This is the saying of the Arabic language. Everything wants to return to its own source. The source of this ruh is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when it is awakened and when it has been revitalized, it wants to be nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my bondsmen, ibadi, ask you about me, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ, tell them I am very near to them. I am not far off. I am very close to their hearts. I am nearer to them than their jugular veins. I am with them wherever they are. هُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَنَ مَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you are. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانَ. I respond to the invocations. I respond to the prayers, supplications of my bondsmen. إِذَا دَعَانَ. Where and when they call me. Where and when they pray me. I listen to their prayers. I accept their prayers. I respond to their supplications and prayers. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. Now this is the other aspect, as I told you today, that the relationship between Allah and His bondsman is two-sided. فَاسْكُرُونِي أَسْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, I will remember you. If you mention me in your heart, remember me in your heart, I will remember you in my heart. If you mention me in a gathering, I will mention you in a much higher and better gathering. Gathering of the Malaikatul Muqarrabun. I will mention my bondsman. My such and such bondsman is mentioning me. He is remembering me. He is preaching my word. He is teaching my and conveying my message. So I will be mentioning him. In the same way here, if you want that I should listen to your prayers, if you want that I should accept your prayers, if you want that I should grant your requests, you should also listen to me. You should also hearken to me. You should also respond to me. You should also accept my commands. فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي. So they should also listen to me. They should also respond to me. They should also have faith in me. وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ. So that they are led aright and they go straight to the final destination, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be pleased with them. Radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. There will be a mutual pleasure of both. Allah will be pleased with them and they will be pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, the two-sided bilateral relationship. Radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Now this ayah has another aspect of importance. And that is, that this is the biggest Magna Carta of the rights of human beings that was given to humanity 1400 years ago. Otherwise, human beings were at the mercy of people who said to them, well, we are intermediaries between you and Allah and your God. You have to please us before you can place your applications and your prayers and your wishes and your requests to Allah, to your God. All the peers, all the pandits, all the pujaris, you know this is P. Everywhere you will find this word, peer, Pandit, Pujari, Parohat, Pope. All you know it's from thee. And they have been exploiting humanity. Actually, this is the biggest exploitation. One exploitation was in the economic field through the landlords, through the feudals, through the kings. They are extracting taxes from the people. People are working hard in the fields. But when it is harvested, the lion's share is taken by the landlord or the feudal, the lord. And the biggest part goes to the king. So these were the two exploitations. The political exploitation of man and the religious exploitation of man. You have to present here something. That is why in that temple of Somnath, the amount of wealth, gold, that was gathered over there. Where from did it come? From people who had, some applications, some wishes. They wanted to pray to their gods, and they had to please, the custodians of that temple first. So that was actually, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has freed us. Pirane kalisa ko kalisa se utha do. Kyo khaliq o makhluk mein hail rahe parde? There shouldn't be any distances between the creator and the created. They can communicate directly. You can communicate with me wherever you like. It's only you don't want to communicate with me. Because you have a guilty conscience. Because you are earning haram. You are eating haram. You don't have the faith to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't have the tongue to talk to Him. Because you know. Everybody knows what He is. He knows what I am. Therefore He wants, some other ways, by hook or crook, you please some peer and you place something on the grave of some big waliullah, and then all your wishes will be granted. So that is actually a very cunning way of exploitation that has been given an end by this ayah. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. You need not go anywhere to call me. You need not please anybody to call me, to be able to communicate with me, only whenever you like, but with sincerity. Make a firm resolve, I will respond to Allah's call, I will listen to Him, I will obey Him, I will act according to His commandments, and then talk to Him. He will listen to you. He will grant your requests. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي. The second part of this covenant should be also fulfilled. They also should listen to me, hearken to me, and they also should respond to me, and they also should have real faith in me, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ, so that they reach the final destination of success. وَهِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَىٰ نِسَائِكُمْ. Now this very lengthy ayah, it gives final rules and regulations about the fasting in Islam. Because previously in the former Muslim Ummah, there was no sehri, no eating or drinking after you said your night prayer, for example after Isha, no eating, nothing of the sort, till the next Maghrib, when night starts again. So the fast covered the night as well as the day. Only for a little time between Maghrib and Isha you could eat and drink and nothing else. Here, this now fasting has been reduced to only the daytime, from the dawn to the sunset. So this is another. Then there was no sexual intercourse also permitted during the fasting. Because the night was also included in the fast. So there could be no sexual intercourse between the husband and the wife. So these things were there in as practices among the Jews. And the Muslims of Medina, they were seeing that the psalm in the Jews has these additional limitations. So they thought that they are included in Islamic laws also. Although there was no mention of it before in the Quran, either to the contrary or confirming those regulations. But some people thought that it is not lawful, it is not permissible to have sexual intercourse with their wives. But still, they were doing it. So in a way, they were betraying themselves. They were doing khiyana with their own selves. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned it first in this ayah, and then given the final rules that this is the difference between the psalm of Islam and the psalm of the Jews of the previous ummah. أُحِلَّ لَكُمْ لَيْلَةَ الصِّيَامِ الرَّفَثُ إِلَىٰ نِسَائِكُمْ. It has been made, declared lawful for you to have sexual contact with your wives during the nights of the fasting. The fasting is for the day, not for the night. هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنْ. They are like a covering, because just as the dress. They are like dress to you, and you are like dress to them. This dress covers our body. So actually the intimacy between the dress and the body, so that has been referred to by this simile. They are like dress to you, and you are like the dress to them. هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنَّ. So this close affinity and proximity. عَلَمَ اللَّهُ أَنَّكُمْ كُنْتُمْ تَخْتَارُونَ أَنفُسَكُمْ. It's in the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you were committing khiyana with yourselves. You were betraying yourselves. You thought that this sexual intercourse is contrary to this psalm, and still you were doing it. Only a few might have been doing it, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, mentions it, because with reference to that, He is now giving the final rules about the psalm in Islam. فَتَابَ عَلَيْكُمْ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted your tawbah. He has relented towards you. He is lenient towards you. فَعَفَى عَنْكُمْ. And He has forgiven you. You have done a mistake, committed a mistake. You shouldn't have done this. Although you didn't know it for sure that it is haram. But you thought that it is haram, and still you are doing it. So actually you are betraying yourself. You are doing khiyana, dishonesty with your own self. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has relented towards you, and He has accepted your tawbah, and He has forgiven you. فَالْآنَ بَاشِرُوهُنَّ. Now you can have contact with them. وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. And now you want to, you try to get what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained for you. Now this sexual intercourse, the result is offspring, the result is taskeen, لِتَسْكَنُوا إِلَيْهَا. Everything that is contained in it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not gone into details. But whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained for you, in this contact between the spouses, you can get it, you can have it. وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. فَالْآنَ بَاشَرُوهُنَّ وَابْتَغُوا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. And you can keep on eating and drinking till the white thread of the morning of the dawn becomes evident to you from the black thread of the night. This is again, you know, an expression for the dawn, when that whiteness appeared on the horizon. It's like a thread which is separating darkness from this thread, you know, it is separating the horizon. When the white thread of حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. White thread of the dawn becomes evident to you from the black thread of the night. ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Now when dawn has appeared, stop eating, stop drinking. Now till the setting of sun setting, till the coming of the night, you have to complete this psalm. Now all the restrictions are there. No eating, no drinking, no sexual contact, nothing of the sort. All things prohibited. وَلَا تُبَاشِرُوهُنَّ وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ. An additional limitation. And that is when you are mutakif. What is i'tikaf? To confine yourself to the limits of a masjid, an area, but not the whole of masjid, where really prayers are held. Because there are additional things, amenities, they are not included in the definition of masjid. Masjid is only the place where people really bow and prostrate, and where they offer their prayers. So you restrict yourself, cut off from the other worldly, your routine activities, and now you are absolutely with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remembering Him, praying Him, reading Quran, doing whatever He has commanded to do. So all these things you can do. But you know, you can't go out of these limits of the mosque, except when there is real need. If you have to call to respond to the call of the nature, you can go to the bathroom, the washroom, that's all. But otherwise, you cannot go out. So when you are mu'takif in the masajid, وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ, then you cannot have any sexual contact with your wives, even during the nights of the Sawm. These are for the 10 days, you know, the masnoon etikaf, the last 10 days, after the night of the 21st begins, you know. This is the beginning of etikaf, masnoon etikaf. Nafal etikaf, voluntary etikaf can be for smaller period, can be at any time, during any month, any day. But you know, this masnoon etikaf, which was the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is last 10 days of every month of Ramadan. وَأَنْتُمْ عَاكِفُونَ فِي الْمَسَاجِدِ تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the limitations laid down by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَلَا تَقْرَبُوهَا. Very beautiful. Don't go near them. At certain places in Quran there is لَا تَعْتَدُوهَا. Don't transgress the limits of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Transgressing, you go out from the limits, it's something else. Don't go near them. Keep at a safe distance. If you are very near to it, then it's just possible that you can just cross it. Maybe unknowingly you have crossed the limits, because you are very near to the final limits. So keep at a safe distance from the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has laid down. تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ فَلَا تَقْرَبُوهَا. These are the limitations laid by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So don't go near them. Keep yourself at a safe distance from them. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. In this way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains his ayat. All his commandments are being explained. Everything which was doubtful about this ibadah, this mode of worship of Sawm, now it has been cleared. All the things have been explained. كَذَلِكَ يُبَيِّنُ اللَّهُ آيَاتِهِ لِلنَّاسِ. In this manner Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes his commands, his ayat, clear for the people. لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. So that they can be saved. They don't transgress the laws. They don't transgress the hudud of Allah, the limitations of Allah unknowingly. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made everything clear and plain. وَلَا تَعْقُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. And don't eat up one another's property and wealth بِالْبَاطِلِ, or through false methods, illegal methods, unlawful methods. This can be in many ways. Stealing, you have stolen some property of somebody else. It is illegal. If he gives you himself in gift, you can take it, you can use it. If he has gifted it to you, if he has given you some present, you can take it, you can use it. But if you have stolen it, then it is haram for you, it is impermissible. It is not lawful for you to use it. Stealing, in the same way, now a particular case is being given here. وَتُدْلُوا بِهَا إِلَى الْحُكَّامِ. لَا تَعْقُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Don't eat up one another's property and wealth through illegal means, through illegal methods. And don't present your property and your wealth to the rulers. لِتَعْقُلُوا فَرِيقًا مِنْ أَمْوَالِ النَّاسِ. With the intention that you eat up some part of the people's property bil ism, with sin, unjustly. وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. And you do it knowingly. This is the rishwa. This is, you know, whatever that you present to the people, bribery. You present your money to the judge or to the authority, someone who can do some favor to you. Whatever favor he is doing to you, if he is a government official, it is at the cost of the interest of the government. And if there is some dispute, some case in the court of a judge, and you have pleased that judge through bribery, well, he will do you favor and he will do wrong to the other party. So you are eating the property and the wealth of the other party by giving your wealth to the judge, to the authority, to the person who is sitting in judgment on that matter. So don't do it. This is called bribery. And actually, the hadith, Ar-Rashi wal-Murtashi kilahuma finnar. Rashi means the person who gives bribe. Generally, we think that Rashi is the person who is accepting bribe and who is eating bribe. On the contrary, in Arabic language, The Rashi is the person who is giving bribe. And Murtashi is the person who is accepting bribe. So Rashi is more important. The Prophet ﷺ has first mentioned Rashi, the person who is presenting and who is offering bribe, he is Rashi. And here in the Quran also we are finding that the mention is being made of the people who are giving bribe. Now, تُدْلُوا بِهَا إِلَى الْحُكَّامِ. Don't give your maal, your property, your wealth to the rulers in order that you may eat up and you may usurp the property or wealth of other people بِالْإِسْمِ unjustly and أَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ and you might be knowing it, willfully doing it, then it is haram for you. Now, what is the logical relationship of this ayah with this section? This section started with taqwa. كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ السِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. What is the criterion for taqwa? The criterion for taqwa is, if you are eating halal, you are muttaqi. If you are eating haram, you are not muttaqi. You may be very pious apparently. You may be worshipping, you know, not 5 prayers a day, but 10 prayers a day. But if you are eating haram, you are not at all muttaqi. The real criterion of taqwa is that you must eat and you must earn through halal means and not through haram means. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Azim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-hakim.
Allahu Akbar.
The Islamic Organization of North America, IONA, is an organization dedicated to reviving the Quran into the hearts of Muslims while bringing its message to non-Muslims. The obligations of a Muslim as ordained by the Quran and Sunnah can be understood as having 4 levels. 1. A Muslim is required to develop real faith and conviction, iman, in one's heart. 2. A Muslim is required to live a life of complete submission to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 3. A Muslim is required to propagate and disseminate the message of Islam to humanity as a whole. 4. A Muslim is required to try his utmost in establishing the just Islamic order. The first and foremost objective of establishing IONA is to assist the Muslims in North America to uphold and implement these obligations, first on themselves, their families, inform their friends, and then to invite the non-Muslims to Islam. The ultimate goal is to seek Allah's pleasure and salvation in the hereafter. For more information about IONA, please visit us at www.tanzeem.us. You may also email us at info@tanzeem.us. or call our toll-free number, 866-779-IONA. Join us. Together, we can make a difference.